welcome to First Presbyterian Church, because First Presbyterian is wherever the people of First Presbyterian are worshiping. There is always life happening in the body of Christ, even in this strange situation as we now find ourselves in November of this pandemic. There is still a lot that's happening right here. For one thing, I wanted to let you know that this week, with the blessing of the personnel committee and the staff, I'm going to be taking a few days off. My sister was planning on coming earlier for a visit to Iowa, and COVID got in the way, and luckily I'm able to take some time this week to do that. So I will be leading worship from Iowa next Sunday, and everybody else will be here. Starting Tuesday, November 8th, which is a week from tomorrow, we are going to try something out. There will be more information coming in the newsletter and the and e-blasts and all of that, but I wanted to give you a heads up about this. We are going to try something out. We're going to try scheduled music meditations for up to 8 people. So we will be scheduling, this is not a drop-in event, but scheduling a time when people can come and listen to the beautiful piano and organ music. We'll have 2 different sections from 1 o'clock to 1:20 and from 1:40 to 2 p.m. Starting on November 8th. But you have to schedule ahead of time. You have to wear a mask, you have to stay distanced, and you can only come just as your time is about to start and then leave right away. We're gonna try this for 2 weeks to make sure that we can do this safely. And if you wanna hear more about that, we will be sending more information soon about that. And you can contact Linda at her accounting email address if you are interested. Her email address is accounting@firstpresmacomb.org. But again, it's not a drop-in event. It's something that you need to schedule to be one of those 8 people that's here. And then we're gonna try to fit as many people as we can in as time passes. I'm sorry, November 10th. I'm being told that the 8th is not a Tuesday. I only think in terms of Sundays. Okay, so November 10th. And then last but not least, it is November now, and so we are working towards Christmas Eve in the church. And so with that, you've probably seen some of the information that's been out there. We have been inviting people to serve as readers for our Christmas pageant. That's going to be a lot of pre-recorded work. And then we also want to get your pictures. There's information out there, again, in the e-blasts and on social media and all of that. But if you would like to, if you're willing to share your voice or share a picture, please contact Connie LaRue. Since we won't be together in person, we want to make sure that we can involve as many people in the body of Christ as possible. And with that, I would like to invite Marcia McCormick to unmute herself and share our minute for mission this morning.
Since 1888, Presbyterian women have expressed their deep sense of gratitude for God's blessing in their lives by giving back to people in their communities and around the world. Through the Thank Offering, we can offer fund programs that provide education, relief from disasters, safe housing, training for justice, and so much more. The money we give goes to help people in this country and other countries. I will give 2 examples of needs this year. One in our country is a synod of the Northeast. Family Promise helps families affected by homelessness to gain employment and sustainable housing. On an international level, Gedea Theological College in Ethiopia will receive funds for the construction of a dormitory for female theological students in Dembidolo. Please make your checks to the Presbyterian Women, and on the memo line, put Thank Offering. Please send that to me, Marcia McCormick, Thank you for your help in this worthy cause.
Thank you, Marsha. And with that, I'd like to invite you to join in our call to worship, which is found in our bulletin. God of power, God of wonder, God of abundance, God of our ancestors, of prophets, of us all, with offerings of praise, with eyes turned to you, with hands lifted up and hearts freely given, we call on your name and worship you. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Blessed are you, O God, for you are holy, gracious, and good, the hope of all the faithful. Empower the meek and encourage the poor. Comfort those who mourn and fill humble hearts with gladness. Give food to the hungry, drink to the thirsty, peace to the peacemakers, mercy to the merciful, and honor to the despised. Sustain your saints in ministry until at last they see their reward, the joy of eternal life with you, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
On this day of all days, we come from the trials of life seeking refuge in God's presence. May God still our hearts, quiet our minds, and let God's peace seep into our souls. Please join me in the prayer of adoration and confession as we confess our sin before God. Generous God, you are lavish with your love, and we have plenty of provisions and opportunities made available to us. Yet sometimes we are slow to acknowledge you as the source. Sometimes we are forgetful and take too much for granted. Sometimes we live life with such free abandon that we lose sight of the preciousness of all that we have received. We are sorry too, for we realize that sharing is not something we do well. We are too often of a mind to hoard what we have as if protecting it from getting into the hands of others. We emphasize too strongly the sentiment of ownership and enforce too much the notion of our right to something. We are aware too that sharing is not something the world does well. As we look around, we see that resources, foods, clean water, medicines, and wealth are not evenly available across our world. People like us of the same human flesh endure life in a much harsher way than we experience, but nonetheless, we often think only of our own struggles. Merciful God, forgive our complaining, our demanding nature, our selfishness, and our lack of understanding towards the plight of others. Shake us out of apathy that we may no longer be complicit in the inappropriate sharing of the world's resources, and instead play our part in putting right what is wrong in this world. In your Son's name we pray, amen. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. May the God of mercy, who forgives us all our sins, strengthen us in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Let us pray. Faithful God, how blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Sanctify us by your word and spirit, so that we may glorify you in the company of the faithful. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The gospel reading this morning is Luke, from Luke 4, verses 24 to 26. And Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel at the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, and there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them, except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
As we come into this time of meditating on the word of God together, I'd like to invite you to breathe in deeply. Breathe all the way down into your belly. Feel the Ruach, the Pneuma, the Spirit of God, our Paraclete and companion, moving in and beyond you. There is a lot that's going on right now. And I know that it can feel really heavy. It can be difficult to navigate how to live well as God's people in this topsy-turvy world that we're living in. And so as we breathe, I'd like to invite us to practice a breath prayer. In this prayer, we face the challenges of our community and our world. We recognize the hurt and suffering of others, and to put it very simply, we breathe in the bad, and we breathe out good. Will you practice this prayer with me? As we draw to mind the concerns that we're aware of in our community and our world, we breathe in the challenges, the worries, and the suffering of our neighbors. And in exchange, we breathe out the spirit of relief and peace and shalom wholeness. We breathe in the hard stuff around us, and we breathe God's love out into the world. I get that this might seem counterintuitive, but it's not that we hold on to that hard stuff ourselves and get weighed down by it, but rather we choose to engage in it and allow God to transform it into a compassionate response. Facing the challenges of the world, we breathe in those concerns around us, engage with it, and we breathe out God's love into the world. Today we celebrate All Saints Sunday, and as Presbyterians who come from the Reformed branch of God's family tree, we understand saints to be ordinary people who seek to follow God through thick and thin. Consider this for a moment. Saints are sometimes caricatured as being something separate from the world, but in reality, a saint is very much a part of the real world. While they are also focused on aligning themselves with God's vision, opening themselves up to God's guidance, and letting go of their own sense of control, all in order to magnify God and to love God's people. To be a saint takes vulnerability and courage to engage in the world. It takes letting go of our own sense of control and allowing God to shape us and to guide our way forward. To be a saint isn't about the pretense of goodness, but the everyday, messy, imperfect practice of trusting God through whatever it is that we're going through. To be a saint is to actively engage in caring for those who are hurting, who are outcast and forgotten, even if it doesn't benefit us. So friends, as you continue to breathe in deeply, allowing your breath to be your prayer, Consider someone in your life who has demonstrated this for you, who has demonstrated being an ordinary saint. Draw to mind how it is that they lived. Consider how they faced what was happening around them. Remember how they practiced over and over and over again, trusting God the best that they could through whatever life led them through. And ask yourself, what would it be like for you and for us to live as saints in our own time and place? This morning, the narrative lectionary brings us to the story of 1 Kings chapter 17. And it's the story of two very different saints who God brought together to practice following God during a time of great hardship. The story skips us ahead in the greater story of God. So let me begin by refreshing your memories about how our story has brought us here. A couple weeks ago, we heard Hannah's story of suffering and then of redemption, and we heard her proclamation about how God was working to turn the world upside down. She declared that in the kingdom of God, the bows of the mighty are broken while the weak are armed with strength. The well-fed hire themselves for bread while those who are hungry hunger no more. Hannah sacrificially offered up her child Samuel to live in God's service, and Samuel became a faithful priest and prophet. During his time, the people of Israel demanded a king like the neighboring tribes had, and so God worked through Samuel to raise up a guy named Saul to become the first king of Israel. And as you might remember, in the kingdom of God, leaders are meant to listen for God's guidance. They are raised up for the purpose of representing God's way. God loves creation and wants us to flourish as God in God's interdependent design of shalom. And so in the kingdom of God, the purpose of a leader is to help people to fully align their lives with God's compassion for the world. But King Saul didn't follow in God's ways. Saul became violent and jealous. And so later David was raised up to become the next king of Israel. But tragically, there was also unchecked sin in David's family tree, the sin of greed and violence and idolatry. And that unrepented sin would go on to wreak havoc from generation to generation. And so the United Kingdom of Israel didn't last long before it was split into two, the Northern Kingdom of Israel and the Southern Kingdom of Judah. Both of these kingdoms continued to suffer from the greed and injustice of their kings. But the baddest of the bad, the king who is remembered as the most faithless and the most apostate of all the kings of Israel, was Ahab. Ahab married Jezebel, the daughter of the king of Sidon. Jezebel brought the worship of Sidon's gods to the northern kingdom, and Ahab built a temple for those gods. And this is how the Bible describes Ahab. He did more to provoke the anger of the Lord, the God of Israel, than any of the other kings of Israel before him. The injustice and violence of Ahab and Jezebel was legendary, and the life of the people of Israel was looking terribly bleak. But God wasn't about to give up on them. God was going to take that destructive situation and transform it with compassion. And so with very little introduction, this morning we meet a prophet, and he's just an ordinary saint, just someone listening for God's guidance and then doing whatever he could to serve God's mission of restoration in the world. So let's open up our Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 17, starting at verse 1, to hear what happens next. Our story and God's story continue with these words. Elijah from Tishba, an inhabitant of Gilead, confronted Ahab. And he said, "As Adonai, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, there will be neither rain nor dew in the years ahead, unless I say so." Then the word of Adonai came to him, "Get out of here, turn to the east, and hide in the Wadi Crete near the Jordan. You are to drink from the stream, and I have ordered the ravens to feed you there." So Elijah went and acted according to the word of Adonai. He went and he lived in the Wadi Kerit near the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the stream. And after a while, the stream dried up because there was no rain in the land. And then the word of Adonai came to him again, "Get up, go to Zarephath, a village in Sidon, and live there. I have ordered a widow there to provide for you." So Elijah set out and he went to Zarephath. On reaching the gate of the city, he saw a widow there gathering sticks. And he called out to her, "Please bring me a little water in a container for me to drink." As she was going to get it, he called after her, "Please bring me a piece of bread in your hand." And she answered, "As Adonai your God lives, I have nothing baked, only a handful of meal in a pot and a little oil in a jug. Here I am gathering a couple sticks of wood so that I can go and cook it for myself and my son. After we've eaten that, we will die." Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go and do what you said, but first use a little of it to make me a small loaf of bread and bring it out to me. After that, make food for yourself and for your son. For this is what Adonai, the God of Israel, says, 'The pot of meal will not get used up, nor will there fail to be oil in the jug, until the day Adonai sends rain down on the land.'" She went and acted according to what Elijah had said, and she, he, and her household had food enough to eat for a long time. The pot of meal did not get used up, nor did there fail to be oil in the jug, in fulfillment of the word of Adonai spoken through Elijah. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Often in our story, it is the characters who are the most open to following, often in our story with God, the characters who are the most open to following God are the most outcast of society and those who are just trying to get by day after day. There's something about realizing that they themselves are not in control, but that they genuinely need the help of God to get by. And from that place of vulnerability and trust, they are able to serve God's kingdom in ways that the privileged have a harder time with. Have you noticed this? I know I've seen it time after time. I've lived with and worked alongside people who are stuck in the crushing cycles of poverty and exploitation in the Philippines. I've seen the resilience of immigrant workers in meatpacking plants in Iowa and women who survived human trafficking in Miami. I've heard the stories of those who are experiencing discrimination and poverty right here in Macomb, while others with much more privilege are able to skate by with more than enough. And I think of that first beatitude, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Or as the Message paraphrase puts it, "You're blessed when you're at the end of your rope. With less of you, there is more of God and God's rule." When we go through hard times, there is an opportunity to deepen our faith. To be real, going through hard times does not automatically make us more faithful. King Ahab clung to his idols and closed his mind to God's way. When faced with adversity, he acted instead out of defensiveness and self-interest and violence. But on the other hand, when Elijah faced hardship, he listened for and followed God's guidance even when it wasn't easy. Elijah trusted God in a whole life kind of way. He practiced that trust when he spoke God's message to Ahab, knowing that Ahab wouldn't want to hear what he had to say. Ahab had built his life, his leadership, and his kingdom around worshiping the god Baal, this god who was thought to be in control of storm clouds and fertility. And so Adonai, the Lord's message of an incoming drought, confronted this false god by showing just how empty and impotent that false god was. With this unwelcome message from God, we can only imagine how desperately Ahab would be to silence this dissension. To follow God, to live as a saint, is to is to listen for God's guidance and speak truth to power, even when the powerful don't want to hear anything that contradicts with their worldview. Well, God told Elijah to flee to the desert and to trust in God's providence as ravens brought his daily rations. And ravens were considered unclean animals by the Israelites. Ravens could also be a euphemism for the Bedouin people. Either way, to follow God's guidance meant that Elijah was not going to be in control. He didn't get his own way. He didn't get to hoard his provisions to make sure that he'd have enough for the next day. To be a saint meant to actively trust God and to live in mutual relationship with the created world around him. And it didn't end there. The drought continues on, and the wadi that Elijah depended on for water dries up. And so Elijah listened, and God guided him to go next to Zarephath, to Sidon, to a widow who would provide for him there. And I wonder if this was the hardest assignment that Elijah had experienced so far. In contrast to King Ahab of Israel, this woman couldn't have gotten described as lower on the hierarchy. She also couldn't have been described as more of an outsider to the original audience of the story. She is an unnamed, unredeemed widow who is living in abject poverty. The idea that Elijah, an Israelite man, would need to depend on a marginalized widow for care would have been seen as absurd. In that patriarchal society, widows lived on the ragged edge of survival with no way to work to provide for themselves. And then we add in a dependent child and a drought exhausting the land. It would have been assumed that she wasn't worth the prophet's time and that she would have had nothing to offer. On top of that, Zarephath was dependent on Israel for food. If there was a lack of food in Israel because of the drought, then there was an even greater lack of it in Zarephath. And not only that, but this woman would have been assumed to be Elijah's enemy. Elijah has fled from King Ahab and Queen Jezebel only to find himself in Jezebel's home country, a nation that worshiped Baal. There just wasn't a more dangerous or foolish place for the prophet of God to be at that time. And still, God intentionally brings Elijah and this widow together to depend on one another for their survival. Imagine what that would have been like for the prophet Elijah. Imagine following God's call to speak truth to corrupt powers of your own country, only to have to flee in fear for your life. And then the person who God brings you to for mutual care is the opposite of a powerful Israelite, but instead a vulnerable foreign widow who has only enough meal and oil to make one last tiny loaf of bread for her and her young son before they die. Think about it. Would you follow God if it meant giving up your security and your known world and depending on someone who is outcast and marginalized for mutual care? I think for those of us with privilege, those of us who generally know where our next meal is coming from, those of us who are used to being the ones determining who is worthy of our charity, we might be tempted to stop following God there. But Elijah chose to follow God. And then there's that widow from Zarephath. Imagine what it was like for her at that time. She's in dire straits. She is convinced that she has nothing to offer. Life has dealt her one devastating blow after another, and finally it seems that this is the end for her and her son. They only have enough flour and oil to make one last small loaf of bread. She was only at the city gate in order to gather a few sticks that she could prepare that last meal. And then here comes this dusty Israelite asking her for a little water and then asking her to share that last bit of food with him. Who could blame her if she told this stranger no and went home to eat that last meal alone with her child? But that wasn't who she was. So she baked something first for the foreigner and then baked something for her and her son. She showed the stranger the hospitality that he had not received from the privileged and powerful of his home country. She was an outsider and the supposed enemy of the Israelites, and yet she is the saint who reveals the faithfulness of Yahweh God. She cared for the other, a complete stranger, even when it didn't look like it would benefit her, and even when things looked hopeless. And through her act of trust and hospitality toward a stranger, she received the abundance of God's care throughout the time of drought. By the mercy of God, the flour and the oil don't run out. And like the manna in the wilderness or the provisions brought daily by the ravens, the widow, her son, and Elijah found that God faithfully provided enough for them to keep going day by day by day through that hard time. This is the gospel. It's not the prosperity gospel by any means, but this is the gospel of grace and of restoration. This is the gospel that Jesus would proclaim everywhere he went. This is our story as the people of God. In good times and in hard times, we find God is already at work, encountering ordinary saints like Elijah and this woman from Zarephath, and transforming them and the world around them. God is always inviting us to join in relationship with others and to turn the world upside down, restoring the world to shalom wholeness. As I've been meditating on this story lately, I've been struggling with it a little bit. I've been struggling with how hard it can be to follow God and to be the church when we don't listen for God's guidance, and when we can get so mixed up about what it means to follow God. We can get mixed up thinking that being a Christian is a matter of showing up for worship on Sunday morning, or we might think that to be a Christian means maintaining some tradition that we see as normal, or maintaining a building as long as we can. But at the heart of Christianity is the call to listen for and to follow God's guidance as revealed through Jesus of Nazareth. At the heart of being a saint is being willing to join in mutual care with God's world, especially alongside those who are seen as having nothing to offer, those who are outcast, suffering, lost, and doubting. At the heart of this life of faith is the realization that we are just as dependent on God's grace as everybody else is, and that it is in this interdependence that we find God's resurrection and abundant grace. The future of the church will depend on our willingness to go out into our community to walk alongside others as Jesus did in mutual relationship. And not just caring for people who are like us, but people who we too easily separate ourselves out from. So, dear saints of God, breathe in deeply the Spirit of God and breathe God out into the world. And as you breathe, listen for what God is speaking to you through this story. Notice which character in this story you relate to the most at this time. Our own contexts are different than that of Elijah and the widow of Zarephath, and still God is guiding us in our own time and place. Sometimes we are the widow at the end of our resources, and sometimes we're Elijah following God's guidance, even when it's scary or it seems absurd. Sometimes we're like the widow who sacrificially shares her resources to provide a meal for a stranger, and sometimes we're like Elijah, who out of his own vulnerability and developing faithfulness offers God's assurance that the famine will one day end, maybe not as quickly as we'd like, but we'll have each other to make it through until then. So church, be still, listen for God. Consider what God is calling you to notice in this story. Consider how God is teaching you to practice faithfulness. Consider one way that you could practice this faithfulness this week, and listen. May we tune our ears to God's call and promise. May we let go of anything that is holding us back from wholeheartedly following God. May we step forward in faith even when it doesn't seem like it will benefit us. May we be led by God's preferential care for the marginalized, the poor, and the suffering. And may we never stop seeking the way of God. May it be so. Amen.
We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. Knowing this truth, we hold nothing back from the God to whom we belong, offering with thanksgiving a portion of what God has entrusted us to steward. If you're able to share your offering this morning, please know that there is information for how to do so at the end of our bulletin.
Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. People will come from east and west, north and south. All the citizens of God's kingdom will feast forever in glory. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right to give our thanks and praise to you, the God of Abraham and Sarah and Hagar, Miriam and Moses, Hannah, David and Isaiah, priests and prophets, of Elijah, an unnamed widow and a child, apostles and martyrs and unknown ordinary saints. You are the God of our ancestors and of our children to all generations. You, everlasting one, made us all. You fashion us into one people and continue to love us, even when we deny our godly heritage. Still, you call us home to you through the saints dedicated to your will. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with all the people of faith of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your name, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, most gracious God, for the gift of your child, our brother Jesus the Christ, who lived in accord with your will to the point of laying down his life for the good news he preached and passed on to us. On the night of his arrest, he taught us how to serve one another in love with a ritual of table fellowship, enjoyed by Christians of all times and places. And so, in remembrance of our Lord Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves with thanksgiving as living sacrifice. In union with Christ's offering for us, we live out the mystery of the faith we proclaim. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Spirit of the living God, make us one as we partake of these your gifts to us, so that we might be in communion with you and with one another. As we break bread together, may our eyes be open to see your glory. As we lift the cup of salvation, may we be strengthened to follow your way. Until Christ comes in final victory and we feast together with all the saints at God's great family reunion, keep your church one in service to the world here and now. Even as we pray for the world you so love, speak your peace in the world where wars rage and violence triumph. We are listening here for your guidance. We lift before you our prayers for the health of all nations, that all people may flourish, for the upcoming elections in our country, for all people in positions of power over others' lives. Hear our prayer. May your will be done, may your kingdom come. Hear our prayers now for those who grieve. Hear our prayers for those who are sick. Hear our prayers for those who are struggling to live the fullness of your resurrection. Send forth comfort as only you can. Forgive our sin, Holy One, as we forgive others, and remember our making. Work with who we are, where we are, to form these clay pots into vessels of living praise, that our lives may participate in the same unending song of the universe, raised by all the saints. We pray this in the name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ, and we join our voices together to pray the words that he taught his disciples, saying, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. And Jesus said, I am the vine, and you are the branches. Come to me and never be hungry. Believe in me and never thirst. Friends, this is the Lord's table. It's not a Presbyterian table. It's not First Presbyterian's table. This is the Lord's table. And our Savior invites all who seek to trust in him to share in this meal that he has provided. And so with that, church in our many places, let us join in the sacrament as the body of Christ. Please join me in a prayer. God of glory, in this holy feast, you have made us one with Christ and with that great multitude of the faithful, those who hunger and thirst no more, and who worship night and day in your temple. Give us grace to follow the example of their steadfastness and their faithfulness. To your honor and glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
now, friends. Go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support those who suffer. Honor all people. Worship and serve the Lord your God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of our relational God, Creator, Christ, and Advocate, be with you now and forevermore. Amen.